Hey guys, welcome back to Ollie's Zoo for another episode. And today I'm going to undertake a bit of an ambitious video with all the editing and stuff like that. Should be interesting to see how that goes. But basically I'm going to take you through on a tour of all the day-to-day jobs that go on here at Ollie's Zoo. It's not a full encompassing vision of everything that does go on in the zoo room all the time, but it gives you an idea of the basic routine jobs that we get up to. So I'm going to be taking you through all the husbandry routines that we do, cleaning, health checking, feeding, that type of thing. So yeah, hope you enjoy the ride. First things first, before we get into any feeding or health checking or anything like that, we usually go through all the rainforest tanks and give them a good spray in the mornings, and then this way when the heat lamps come on, the water that's in the tank will evaporate, it'll condensate as it would normally in the rainforest, so we'll go ahead and do that. All it is, it's just a basic mister like this, like you would spray just normal plants, that type of thing. Just give it a really good spray in the tank like that. And obviously this is really good because the droplets that come through the roof of this, which is mesh, by the way, Yoda will usually drink them. And that's why he doesn't have a water dish in his tank, because he usually just drinks the droplets off the leaves, that type of thing. So yeah, not really exciting, but there you go. And I'll just put the heat lamp back on. Next up, it's the firebellies and jabber. So for our amphibians, it's always important that the water that we're using is dechlorinated, like the one that's in here. And all that is, it's just tap water that's been left to sit for 24 hours. Not all the metals that can potentially harm amphibians will drop out of it. And then obviously it won't be harmful to the amphibians that way. There are chemical agents that you can buy in various pet shops that'll do the job for you. You just add the droplets into the water and then it dechlorinates it for you, but I'm a cheapskate, so I have to just let the water sit overnight, so we'll just go ahead. And I do this mainly just to keep this moss alive. I mean, it's humid enough in here as it is, with obviously the water in there. But it was pretty smart as well. You know, it's only to mimic natural rainfall that these animals would see in the wild. Next up, it's jabber, and I don't know if you can see our big bad boy. You can just see that bit of lime green protruding from the soil there. He's buried himself nice and deep in there. So we'll just go ahead and give his tank a good soak. Fancy frogs like it really wet in their tanks. But with it being quite warm here in the UK at the moment, these tanks are drying up pretty quickly, so sometimes you've got to spray them a few times a day just to make sure that it's nice and wet in here for him. And that'll about do. The next job that we get on with after the tank sprays, it's pretty basic. It's just to make sure that the animals here have fresh water in their dishes. So all you do is go into the tank, get the water dish out, into the dirty bucket it goes. I'll just put that one there. And then we come up to King. Same thing again for him. So now that that water dish is nice and clean, all we do, fresh water in there. And same for King. Easy peasy. You're pretty surprised with snakes on the sly. They do like a nice drink of water. But you've got to be very discreet in catching them do it. They won't voluntarily come to a water dish when you're about. You'll often just turn the corner and look in the tank and they'll just be there with their head stuck in water dish. So yeah, it's always important to make sure the snakes have fresh water. So we're in the hognose den now, and I'm not actually sure where they are. Might be underneath here. Nope. That means that they'll probably be in that massive monument there, hiding underneath that. They've got their fresh water. The hognoses, they can be messy buggers when they want to be, so you can just see there some pieces of poo. And you might wonder why it's white. The reason being, snakes have evolved to absorb as much calcium from the food as they can. And obviously when you think about it, they're swallowing a mouse or a rat, that type of thing, that's a whole body. So they're gonna be absorbing all the bones, which are packed full of calcium. And then an indicator of a healthy snake is that they're actually pooing out like these sort of white lumps, if you will, which is just extra calcium that they don't need. So we're gonna go ahead and clean that out. So what I usually do, I just use these empty food trays, which the crickets and walkers usually come in. Get me sieve, put that in there. Don't need that now. And then just sieve it out. And there we go, we can get rid of that mess. And then that's some nice clean hog noses. Okay, so next we're back with our lovely female royal python Bella. She'll be in one of two hides. I think she's actually in that one. Let's just check her out. Yep, there she is. Oh, sorry girl. Let's see. Nope. She's just about ready to shed, is Bella. Her eyes have gone milky, is the term that's used for snake keepers. Obviously snakes, they don't have eyelids, they have eye caps, and an easy way to tell that they're about to shed is that those eye caps will go sort of like a milky white colour as the old skin gets ready to come off. So it's important to make sure that the tank is misted when this happens. And just before they do shed though, they look like they're not even about to shed and they go back to their normal colour, then all of a sudden the shed comes off. So I'm hoping that she'll do one nice big shed for me, and then it'll be time to feed her. So for Bella, all we do, get rid of that dirty water, and then we just give her some fresh water. In it goes. Job done. I'll just put her hide back over her. And again, I'll just spray her tank. It's quite nice and humid in there for her if she's about to shed. It'll make the skin easier to come off. And then, yeah, that's pretty much it. So now we're moving on to the tortoises, moving on to the other side of the zoo room. Margot's got herself in a bit of a pickle here in her grass tray. Oh, there's Maximus in the background. This grass tray was grown by our resident horticulturist at Ollie's zoo. They keep the tortoises and the chickens fed. For the tortoises, these last a few days. Chickens last a few minutes, maybe. obviously, they're full of vitamin D, these, because they've been in direct sunlight. You know, and it's kind of mimicking what these guys have naturally eaten in the wild. Because obviously they are grazers, they're leopard tortoises. So with the tortoises, all you really need to do is make sure that they're all right and that they're moving around. With tortoises, it's a bit easy to tell when they're in ill health. They usually don't really move around a lot, very unresponsive. Margot and Maximus though, they're always moving around, they're always active, they're always got their eyes open, that type of thing. And then all we really need to do then is just give them their fresh water, which I'm sure, give them about half an hour, they'll go take a nice poo in it. But it's alright. So yeah, that's the tortoises done. Now we're back here with the bearded dragons, Dup and Caroline. There's Dup, there's Caroline. And they're spending a lot of time under here recently, hiding away from the heat lamp. As I say, it is quite warm in here at the moment, with it being summer here in the UK, so these are two bearded dragons that are doing the opposite of what bearded dragons should. They're hiding away from the sun.
from the heat, whatever you want to call it. So all we do with the bearded dragons, first basic check, make sure that they're looking all right, you know, they're responsive, no cuts on them or anything like that, just a basic visual health check. If they're shedding, then we'll put them in the bath later on. And Caroline, she's actually looking quite pale at the moment around her beard and her face, so she probably is getting ready to shed. But other than that, oh, and look at Dup as well. There, yeah, he's come out. He's definitely getting ready to shed. No doubt about that. All we do now, like how we're doing for the hog noses, just give them a basic spot clean. Get all little bits of dirt out of there, that type of thing. Oh, Dup, it's not food. The bearded dragons, very easy to work with, so well behaved. You know what I mean? Like, you can literally just work with them in the tank. And he did his little licking motion, and I don't know if the camera caught it. He'll be just testing out his environment. All the little bits that are in here, that type of thing. Hello, buddy. You want to come out? Okay. And I bet it does it really for the beardies. For now, anyway. Well, yeah, we'll see you soon, Dup. So we're here now at the guinea pig pet corner, and it's Sunday, so that means one thing, it's guinea pig cleaning day. This job usually takes about 20 minutes, half an hour if you're slow, and it's more of a moving stuff around and making sure everything's in the right place. To clean up and stuff like that, that takes a while, and the actual cleaning itself. So we'll just go ahead and get our piggies out. There's our lovely mummy Smudge. And again, all you do, basic health check on her, make sure she's looking all right. And off she goes into the carrier. Here's our little girl Rolo, you probably recognise her from our guinea pig video. And again, same thing with her. Just a quick health check, make sure she's alright. Off into the crate she goes. Last but not least, our big boy Rocky. Hello buddy. Again. Just a quick health check, make sure he's all right. Off into the crate he goes. Here's the guinea pig cage, looking very untidy. Lots of poo and biscuits all over the place. Needs a really good clean. So I'll just leave you with this, and then I'll show you the finished results after I'm done. So there we go. Nice clean guinea pigs. With fresh hair, shavings, got the biscuits there. You coming forward, Smudgy? Nope. Come on, guys. So, yeah, that's pretty much it. We've got their fresh water as well. Guinea pigs, they have their water bottles topped up as and when they need to be. And with how warm it is at the moment in the UK, that's quite regularly, to be honest with you. Because they can drink up to a litre of water a day, and that's just individually, never mind the three of them. So these water bottles are kept topped up regularly. They're the biscuits I was telling you about in the guinea pig video, rather than the muesli mix. It's just a corrugated pellet full of all the vitamins and nutrients that they need, and then they'll have their peppers or carrots or whatever later on. Their hay is full of fibre, and is a necessity for all herbivorous animals, as it helps them to digest the plant matter better that they eat, all that fibre, that type of thing. Rabbits, guinea pigs, large rodents that are kept as pets need a handful of hay every day. You know, and that's a necessity again, there's no getting around that. So yeah, the hay is an essential. They have the nice blanket that they go up and sleep on at night time. They do like the comfort of the guinea pigs, which makes them quite interesting to me, to be honest with you. They show classic examples of animals that actually enjoy comfort, and so that's not just cats and dogs. Rodents are capable of that as well. So yeah, we'll just leave them happily eating their hay there. The last thing that we've got to do now is make sure that all the animals that have been well behaved today get their food. Now for the piggies, obviously they've got the hay and the biscuits and the water, but because they've been so well behaved in that in their crate when they were getting cleaned up, I'm going to get some nice kale. There you are, guys took it. So it's important to make sure that guinea pigs have fresh veg, if not every day, then every other day at least. And that encompasses carrots, peppers, these type of leaves like kale, salad leaves, that type of thing. Tend to stay away from iceberg lettuce just because of how sharp it is. It can cut the stomach lining if it's fed too much in excess. But veg has a lot of vitamin C in it, and obviously guinea pigs are deficient in vitamin C, so yeah, very important to feed them fresh veg, make sure they don't get any deficiencies or health problems, that type of thing. Time to have a look at the bearded dragons again. Again, they're having kale today, and I think there's a few Morio worms in there hiding. In fact, you can just see one just slithering away there into the leaves. For bearded dragons, they're being a bit camera shy now, but I was hoping that they'd eat the veg in front of you, but never mind. Bearded dragons, obviously with them being omnivores, the veg is just an important part of their diet, as the live foods like the crickets and locusts, the mealworms, morio worms, that type of thing. And obviously as they get older, it's more important that they have the veg to keep them lean and to prevent them from coming overweight. For more information on that, there is my bearded dragon nutrition video, which is I'm over the moon with how many views that got. As I said, clearly you guys like the bearded dragons, so I'm going to try and include them as often as I can in the videos in the future. So come on guys, eat up. And then last but not least, we've got our bad boy Yemen chameleon Yoda. Looking grand as always, and he's looking very hungry as well. There we go. Easy peasy. Find it's a lot easier to tweezer feed him. He used to be in a smaller vivarium when he was a lot younger, when he was in there I used to put three or four crickets in there for him, and he used to be able to find him on his own. He'd go hunting for him, that type of thing, but because the vivarium is in now, terrarium, whatever you want to call it, it's so overgrown and so dense that I could put a couple of locusts in here, I don't think he'd actually find them. I find it much easier just to tweezer feed him, really. And the thing is, with locusts especially, they carry little internal parasites inside of them. So the general rule of thumb with them, and most live foods really, crickets, mealworms, never leave them in the tank longer than half an hour if the lizard hasn't eaten them, so that they don't spread disease or anything like that your lizard can pick up. So it's just, you know, good husbandry in my book to tweezer feed them, really. So yeah. Well, we're back to where we started at the beginning of this video, with the pythons. I'm just sat here with my spider royal python king, just chilling after all that hard work. I hope you've enjoyed this video. I don't know how it's going to come out with the editing and stuff like that. Hopefully it's good. I hope you guys enjoy it. I hope you enjoy these videos as much as I enjoy making them. Of course, animals are my passion. They always have been, and with any good grace, they always will be. You know, so I just love to share that passion with you guys, and tell you everything I know about animals, and you know, just try and show you what amazing creatures reptiles are. You know, not to say that all the other animals I've got aren't amazing.
So yeah, we'll see you on the next video, guys. Thanks for all the support, all the views, all the likes on the videos, you know. It really makes my day to check on the videos and see all, you know, there's been a few more views. Bit by bit they go up, you know, it's really cool. You know, obviously I couldn't do that without you guys watching the videos, so I appreciate it. See you later.